Thank you. Thank you, man. My man. Everybody's all right? Well, thank you for inviting me to be here. I feel very privileged to spend some time this Sunday evening. As I've talked about, we have an energy project, Akon and I, in Samba, in response to one of the most pressing issues that we have in the continent today. The time we speak now, there is 600 million Africans, your brothers and sisters back home, who, if we don't do nothing, will continue to live in the dark. They will never have the opportunity that you have, that I got, which is coming to one of the greatest schools in the world, here in MIT, looking for knowledge and networking with the people, so tomorrow you can go around and build something for yourself and hopefully for your community. But I will say what President Obama said, is that if your goal in life or your objective is just to make a buck, get a degree and build a house and get a beautiful cars and et cetera, nothing wrong with that, but then you have no ambition. We are the lucky ones here. Back home today, until now, if you go to the rural areas that we went to in Kenya, in Cotonou area, just past Cotonou, if you go to outside of Dakar, outside of Accra in Ghana, you will find women who, in the middle of the night, have to deliver a baby and still cannot find a hospital to go to. Right now, we're losing young people in the streets of Dakar, begging every single day to get a meal to eat. Every single day in Africa, millions of dollars are coming out of those bank accounts, transferring to Europe, the United States, and China from deals in infrastructure and et cetera. That's why everybody in the world is talking about how Africa is the place to go for some people. But today, the Senegalese lambda, the African lambda, the regular African cannot find $1 to eat. This is the challenge that we're facing. You, the young Africans, who are now on that stage that Nkrumah was, Patrice Lumumba, Senghor, Ofid Bouanye, those young people like you who studied in Europe back in the 50s and just had dreams in London and in France and et cetera that had independence. They've achieved that. But now, my question to you and us, the new generation of Africans, who stood on top of those people today, on their shoulders, what is our dreams for Africa? What are we going to do to change the spectrum? What story we want to create for our children? This is why I left the United States to spend more time in Africa, because everywhere you look is something to be done. In the energy sector, Akon and I teamed up in Samba to bring our contribution in the Akon Lighting Africa. Today we are in 18 countries touching millions of Africans that actually changed my life in the process. And I saw another issue, which in Senegal, when I was eating, and I see the chebujan, the jollof rice, majority of it, the original jollof rice. My Nigerian friends. You must be from Nigeria, okay. So, majority of that is coming from, the rice is coming from Pakistan, Indonesia, and Malaysia, and etc. We got oil coming all the way from Ukraine, vegetables from Morocco, and etc. Yet we have 60% of edible land in Africa. 365 days out of the year, we have some sun, unlike Boston. All right? The youngest generation, the youngest population in the world is in sub-Saharan Africa. I have a problem with that because I don't think that we can have independence if we cannot feed ourselves. And I cannot wait for government to do it. I cannot wait for anyone to come to do it. I have to show the example by getting a farm myself and that everything I eat and my family come from my farm first. Then I can try to duplicate that. This is the reason why I started Jeff Zone Farms, which today is opening stores around Dakar selling bio food, everything organic. what I saw is that most of the food that we got from overseas is put into freezers and boats and etc. when they come home. And today, Senegal and Africa, everywhere in Africa now, we get disease that we didn't get before because most of our food is frozen. Can you imagine? I was in Gambia last month now, in the Gambia, a coastal country that we have fish everywhere. Having fish that's coming from Brazil and Germany and those countries is cheaper than getting fish in the Gambia. Imagine that. So I'm telling you this thing to tell you that we, generation, the new generation, we've got some serious work to do. And your work is needed more in Africa. Whatever you do here, that experience, you bring it back home, it is needed. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to open it up, instead of talking the whole 30 minutes that I got, into questions. I want to answer or talk about the things that you got in your mind instead of giving a speech. So if you have a question, raise your hand. We'll give you the mic. I hope they have a mic walking around. And I'll come closer. We have a small dialogue before we finish up. We got the sister right here. Thank you very much.
I don't need a mic.
Here you go.
I do research. My research project is for Liberia to institute reaction wear into the devastated areas, labs in Liberia. That's one of my research projects. But I have a gentleman who has arable land that he's bought in Liberia, mm-hmm. and he's having problems getting support to farm, make it useful. Any connection I can bring to him would be wonderful. He has bought and purchased his land. He's in Maryland, and he is really waiting to be able to make that sustainable, not just farm it, but make it sustainable for the area. And as you know, Liberia has a devastation that's just after the Civil War, the devastation there is incredible. So
very good.
Anything.
Well, you got a connection here.
Right.
We're going to have a talk after this.
All
Thank
right.
you very much. God bless.
Right.
Thank you. The next one, brother. We got one person here. You need a mic? Okay.
Thank you. Yes, my name is Shalkan Montana from Philadelphia. My question I want to ask you is there's this rhetoric where people say the younger generation has to come back to Africa. But if you're second, third generation, right, you don't really have those connections back home, what would you advise somebody like that in that position to do?
How do you go
back to Africa if you have nobody there?
Well, that's a good question. Give him a round of applause for that. Thank you. I think going back to Africa doesn't mean you're physically in Africa. I believe that we need Africans in the continent, but we need Africans abroad too. Because what's happening at home now, you see the power that the diaspora is bringing into money is huge. But if you look at Washington, D.C. today, for example, if you go to Congress, thankfully now we're getting slowly some Africans in there. Our sister from Minneapolis is in there now. But prior to that, when I was working on the Hill a few years ago, every time you talk about African issues, we're nowhere to be found, whether in the State Department or in Washington, D.C., in the White House, etc. How can we change that? It's because if we, people like you who can be influential on African interest in Washington, in Boston, wherever you are. And you can't do that by being at home. But if you can be home, it's even better. We need more people to come and build projects on the ground. But it doesn't mean you just have to pack your stuff and go when you're not ready to do that, because everybody cannot do it. I can do it. It's easy for me to go. Because I don't work for no one. I work for myself. But for some people who got jobs here, you got to figure out somewhat how can you help from far. We got people who are doing a lot for Africa, and they are not even African. Africa, being an African and supporting Africa is on the heart. And now with technology, it can be utilized to build the projects, to teach, to share everything we're doing from the internet. So with technology. So that's what I'm advising, using technology, but also building more people who can go do the work, be a mentor to somebody who can do on the ground. We got a lot of young Africans who will look up to you. If you take 1 year, 1 week a year to go find some young people who are doing great on the ground and mentor them, they need more of that. That's what I can say to your question. Thank you for asking that. Yes, we got one here.
We have one here.
Yes, go ahead. We got to get the sisters. Let's go. Let's get a sister and a brother and a brother and a sister, okay? All right. Yeah.
So here's my question. As part of the project you're working on at Rice, right?
Yes.
For the second time this week, I've heard a statistic on the amount of arable land. First of all, Africa is the red basket in the world. I heard that this week. Second statistic, the amount of arable land is reducing. But as it turns out, for patches of land right there in desert, you can actually turn them back into arable land. And there's a project out of Norway called the Sahara Project, which has shown on a pilot scale based in Jordan that they're turning patches of desert back into arable land. Are there any considerations for especially those countries in the Sahel, like Senegal and others, to start reclaiming what is a significant amount of land between the Maghreb and West Africa and turn that into useful land?
Well, thank you. That's a good point. But to me, before I even go talk about the desert area, there's the edible land. I got water. I got everything flat in my neighborhood that nobody's touching. That's my biggest worry now. How can I utilize what's in my feet? I was in Kaolack, where I was born, last week. I got 100 hectares there that I'm working on. But all the farms around are just dead. Nobody. Everyone who was working there, the younger people are in Dakar, selling in the streets or becoming security guards. So my fight now is how can I get those young people interested in agriculture again? Because our elders are getting older, and there's no one else is taking over the lands to do agriculture. When we get people like you to come home to help us, maybe you can take on that fight. But I'm going to focus on what I'm working on now to build a movement towards agriculture, to make it at least sexy again. Because agriculture in Africa is tied into poverty and misery. Every time you talk about agriculture, and this is the reality, let's just face it. If you go to our villages, you go to villages here outside of Boston and Massachusetts, you want to live there. It looks good. You got the infrastructure is good. They got the same thing that the rural people, the city guys have. But in Africa, if you go to the villages, there's no electricity, there's no running water, okay? There's no infrastructure. Many of these young people grew up there. They can't wait to leave. And you can't blame them. When they leave, you can't get them back for good. They're all in Dakar trying to find their way, like me and you got here. So what can I do now to get those young people interested to know that agriculture actually is not the poor man's job? You can make billions of dollars out of agriculture. And we're working it slowly, and it's coming together slowly. Because to go to my farm today is 100, 200 people working there that they would not, never thought they would do agriculture. I have a young man who's a student at Sheikh Anta Job University, a law student last year, came to volunteer for 1 week. Now he decided to do agriculture. He's on my farm now. And those kind of stories that encourage me to continue to do that work. That point you got, we leave it in your hand to help us with that, brother, okay? God bless. The next one, we got a sister.
For the person who talked about
who got the mic?
Like baby, Ryan.
Where is the sisters? Why are you guys going to play this way, though?
Right there.
So for
give them the mic for the next one.
We're willing to help.
Yes, excuse me.
I have been working with ILO on the continent. They are an international labor organization. And we have this regional forum where we're working on scaling up partnership to get young people or people interested in agribusiness around West African region. We held the last forum in Dakar. Coincidentally, you're from Dakar.
Yep.
Yes, so we'll be willing to help. I could introduce, write an email to the regional director, and then we can trickle it down to the country level in Liberia. Then for folks asking about agriculture, we are working with an organization to offer mentorship, Woods and Park, for example, in United Kingdom. To offer mentorship for young people who are interested.
Hey, when are you going to ask for the question, man? We don't got much time.
Oh, sorry. All right. The question I just take that I have to offer this.
Okay.
I say a lot of people have need help, and then that's my hearing.
My man, thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah.
All right. We got the sister. You got one connection over there.
Yeah. Thank you. You're calling us to community, to activism as the diaspora. So we are a team from what we call the Africans in Boston, and our company bringing together African diaspora to help the continent and to help ourselves. But one of challenges we face, and I'm tapping into your expertise, is mobilization. For example, we've been having conversations with the African Union ambassador, you know, how we can engage with the African Union and with the continent. But before we do that, we have to organize ourselves. We are usually the low-income earners, and we face challenges here before we even look at back home. Mm-hmm. So we are trying, for example, to mobilize ourselves to start a financial entity, which is a credit union, to help support our, you know, to interrupt the disparity we have in the financial sector, you know, getting houses and all that. But the challenge is the trust amongst the diaspora themselves. You know, we need the numbers in order for that dream to happen. Mm-hmm. It's a highly regulated industry, that's a financial institution, but we need it so that we can help ourselves in order.
Get to the question. Let's go. I got 30 minutes.
Yeah. Can you help us be a figure to mobilize the communities to come and support?
Well, I'm already here. I've left everything I'm doing at home, and God knows I didn't want to come back to Boston at this time of year. But to me, the work we do demands this too. We need to have more dialogue among each other to encourage each other to do more. If I can do that, anything I can do to support, I'm here to do that. Make sure we talk when we finish to see how I can be of support to what you're doing.
Thank you.
All right?
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Another question. Please make those questions short because they're signaling me. We don't have much time, and I want to get to as much as we can get. This one. Where's the mic?
Okay.
Oh, no, we got to get another sister. Come on. We've only got three guys. We'll get you right back, brother. Give the sister there and here. Three guys, one sister. We got to balance this thing out.
Hi, everybody.
You Africans. Come on now.
Somebody was already talking about arable land. I encountered like a couple of years ago when I was working on that subject and consulting about how foreign countries would come into Africa and acquiring land, arable land in Africa, like years ago, mm-hmm. either buying it very cheaply or leasing it for hundreds and hundreds of years for a very, very cheap price to basically, they are already envisioning the future for agriculture outside of their countries and in Africa.
Right.
And it was like, so those contracts were not fair to contracts for Africans, but there was a lot of governments would be involved in corruption. So I'm just wondering if you have any idea what happened since then, and if there is any will from the governments or from private sector to basically help with regulating this kind of...
Well, the governments are working to... It depends which country you talk about. Let me take that back. I was going to say the governments are working to change the spectrum, making sure it's for the interest of the people. I said, let me take that back. Most of the governments that we all know, let's just say, are working for their pockets. And when Chinese come, I'm just giving an example, sorry, of the Chinese as an example. They come with bags of money. And usually the politicians with the money, they just give them however amount of land they want. People like me who were born in the country, I had a very hard time to find 100 hectares in my country. Because they quickly tell me, come on, you're too young for that. What you doing with 100 hectares? They cannot accept it. Even for our project with me, Akon Lighting Africa, Akon and I are from Senegal, it became very difficult for us to get a contract in Senegal. It's to tell you that the power is always on the way. How do we fix that? It's very simple. We need you guys to come back and run for office. We do. We do. To me, what I learned from President Obama is very simple. The things that we see that we want to change, we just have to be that change. We can't complain about what's not going on in Africa. We can talk about it all day on Facebook, becoming Facebook activists. We are very good at it, or Twitter or Instagram. But until we go on the ground, leave our comfort zones, and let's not be afraid of, let me say, put it this way. A lot of people in the diaspora are afraid to go back home. And I have a hard time to understand that. This is our home. This is where we belong. How can we be afraid to come home? When we left home, most of us left with a drive to change something at home. You remember that night you took the plane to leave? Each one of you, I want you 1 second to take that in your picture. The night you left home, leaving your home country to come here. That night, there was a certain drive in you that you wanted to change so much back home. You didn't leave just to leave. But so many of us, once we come here, we get comfortable, things go well, we start getting a bank account, money coming in, good education, met a good sister or brother, and then got married. And then next thing you know, oh, Africa, man, you're never going to change, the politicians. This is the truth.
Yeah, true.
So how do you expect things to change? Because the cream of our countries is you. You are the blessed ones. You are in one of the top universities in the world. You're one of the best countries in the world. You got greatest, one of the greatest skills in the world. And anything you're doing here, healthcare, education, IT, whatever you do, whatever your field is, Africa needs that today. It's the only country you can come in 5 years, if you focus on something great, you can become a billionaire. Easy. If Europeans can come in a country that they don't even speak our language and Chinese and be so successful, why are we afraid to do it in our own home? Why? So until we come, if you want the political spectrum to change, come run for office. Because if you don't do it, don't blame the ones who are corrupt and running for office. Because the bottom line is, the people are not given the opportunity to see what's good and what's bad. They just got what's bad, which is giving them a little money to eat, and then they vote for them again, and then they come back in election time and vote again. Because they, what I see at home is that many people are living on a daily basis. The majority of our people are living to survive. They don't have time to think about who's the right election. They don't. If you're working every day to just get some rice and oil to feed your family, where do you have time to try to educate yourself who's the right leader to lead you? This is what I found as a problem. So we are educated. We travel the world. We understand what it takes to build a nation. We know exactly how to lead a people. We need you, young Africans abroad, to come home and help the continent. We need you. We cannot have you here. Because if you're here, you will come home in a few years and you become a foreigner in your own country. I promise you that. You know why? Because Europe, United States, Turkish, China, everywhere, everybody, wherever you're going, to the ruralist villages, you'll find foreigners who cannot speak our languages and taking advantage of the economic boom in the continent. And we sit here, we complain about what's not going well, but we do nothing. That's why I'm home. That's why Akon is home. That's why Thione Elimelu is home. That's why Dangote is home. There is nothing like home. I'm so optimistic about the future of our continent, and we need you to be on that. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so
much. Thank you,
man.
Hey, good to have you, man.
The conversation we started in Paris, we're continuing, and we're going to keep going.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
I really want to thank our brother Thione Niang.
No problem.
For inspiring everybody. We can keep going forever, but we have many more topics to discuss before we wrap up in our African time that we're comfortably in now, that we've actually...
Thank you.
I'm
outside. I'll sit here and wait for you.
Yeah,
I got my books and all of that stuff. I'll sign them for people. I ain't giving it for free. You gotta have to buy them too. God bless. Thank you.
Africa,
thank you. Thank you for having me. God bless. I like that outfit.
Some are getting